Hello, and welcome to Science Let It Spin, coming live from L'Antenne in Paris, an event organized by the Solvay Group and the Social Media Club of France. I'm your host, Timandra Harkness. Now, we have people here in the room. People in the room, I'm going to ask you now to turn your mobile phones, preferably off, but at least to silent, so that you don't disturb the event. But if you're watching via the internet, please don't turn your mobile phones off, because we want you to contribute your questions and your thoughts. And there will be 2 points at which we will come to you, and don't worry, people in the room, to you as well, for your questions and your thoughts. So you can tweet those to us at any time with the hashtag TeamScience. We have a panel of 5 speakers here, but we're not going to have speeches or slides. We're going to ask them to have a conversation which will include you at a couple of points. So first, I'd like to thank all the partners that have made this evening possible, and there's lots of them. Pint of Science, you'll hear a bit more about them later, CNRS News, ESPCI Paris, Discovery Science France, ENA France, that's ENA.fr, it's me trying to read abbreviations in 2 languages, SDN School, and Social Media Club of the World, which is like Social Media Club France, but with its eyes on world domination, clearly. So I'm going to introduce the panel to you, and then I'm going to start them off with 1 question, and we'll take the conversation about science and see where it goes. So at this end, we have Tim Lewens, Professor Tim Lewens of the University of Cambridge in the UK. I'm very glad he could be here. Until recently, he was a council member of the Nuffield Council for Bioethics. Next to him, we have Jean-Marie Solvay. Yes, that's the same Solvay as have organized the event. He is a member of both the Board of Directors and the Innovation Board of the Solvay Group. And he's also president of the International Solvay Institute of Physics and Chemistry. On my immediate right, we're very pleased to have Professor Ben Feringa from the University of Groningen. He was the 2016 Nobel Prize winner for chemistry for his work with nanotechnology. He started off working in industry in Shell before he moved to Groningen University. And I gather he made a nano car, which I hope we might hear a little about later. On my left, we have another nanotechnologist, James Kakalios. James Kakalios. I may call you Jim if you don't mind.
Please.
Also works in nanotechnology. He's a professor of physics, but he's also written a book called The Physics of Superheroes. And I see you have a themed tie.
Yes.
So maybe we'll hear a bit more about that later. And at this end on my left, Dr. Elodie Chabrol, who's a neuroscientist, but also does a lot of work in engaging the public with science. So she's the international director of Pint of Science. So again, I hope we'll hear a bit more about Pint of Science and who they are and what they do later. So, panel, to start you off, and perhaps I might actually let you in turn give us your initial thoughts on this. The question we were given at the start of this event, when we started thinking about it, was, is it time we recognize scientists as the unsung heroes who could save the world? That's a suitably large question to start us off for a mere 90-minute event. Mm. Tim, you're a philosopher. You're used to big questions. Is it time we recognize scientists as the unsung heroes who can save the world?
No. And slightly more elaborately, first of all, I think scientists get quite a lot of singing behind them already. I think that scientists are often celebrated. Of course, we know that many of the problems facing the world today, problems about climate change, problems about disease, all of those things absolutely need science to solve them. But the idea that science is going to do it by itself seems to me to be massively mistaken. So, for example, you can't solve medical problems in the developing world simply by bringing new drugs to those countries, even if the drugs work really well. You've got to understand why it is that people seek doctors in those countries. You've got to understand the ways in which the history of colonial influence might have made some people very skeptical about foreign aid organizations. You need to understand all of those things, which means that we need to join up the sciences with the humanities, with the social sciences, if we're really going to solve any of these big problems. And the people who really don't get much singing behind them are the humanities and the social sciences people in this debate.
Well, good. We should start off with some controversy already. So, Jean-Marie, are you going to defend the unsung heroes of science?
Absolutely. Because really where you need to start is you need to start with fundamental science. You need to start with curiosity-driven research. And to do that, it's passion. You have to give the means for the people that are really excited, that are competent, to really drive their passion. For that, they need, I'm going to be blunt, they need money. And fundamental science is funded typically by governments or large companies, but mostly governments because it takes a lot of money. It's like if you look at the CERN, for instance, and the discoveries of particle physics, those are countries that got together and pooled their resources to discover what matter is made of. And it's only once you've gone through understanding very basic and very fundamental questions that you find all the solutions that actually change the life of people. So I totally agree with you that it's not just science that's going to save the world, but without science, it's not going to happen. So again, we need support the fundamental science and the scientists.
Great. I love to start an evening off with some disagreement. We've got something to get our teeth into. Now, Ben, you have been sung. You have a Nobel Prize. But in general, do you think scientists are the unsung heroes? Will you save the world?
I'm not sure if you can call it saving the world. But let me make one thing clear. If you look at the world now and compare it with 100 years ago or 200 years ago, there has a lot that science has done to make such a major impact in the world that you can easily say, yes, to some extent, they saved the world. Yes, I mean, we have now antibiotics, yeah? We have iPhones, we can drive in cars, we can fly in planes. There are a few things, you know, that have been accomplished. But let me make absolutely clear, going far away from practical applications, the basis, the fundament of science is exactly what Jean-Marie said, is about why and how. How do things work? Why? Yeah. What are the essential bases, the fundamental scientific questions that we ask all the time to Mother Nature, the elementary laws, the fundament of why we exist, how we exist, how we are built up, you know, how the world is built up, etc. That working on these fundamental questions will give completely unexpected possibilities. I can tell a little bit on that later, but I think working on really thinking about very fundamental questions is really important to make major breakthroughs that will ultimately open up completely new opportunities for society. And I can give examples about that, but there is not a strong division between science and then humanities. I think there's a gliding scale, of course. On the one side, you have philosophy, and you have theology, maybe you have, on the other side, theoretical physics. I'm more a practical person because I'm a chemist. We build molecules and materials like drugs or fuels for your car. But it's not about so much about direct practicality. It's much more about what are the questions we are going to ask to Mother Nature? Why and how?
Right. This question of the pure, the applied, the division, I think is really important. We'll come back to that. So Jim, you have kind of two hats here. You've written about superheroes, and you yourself also are working on nanotechnology. So do we need to bring more of the superhero into the way we look at science that's being done?
Well, I don't know about having scientists out there fighting crime. But I certainly, I don't know if scientists will save the world, but they've certainly always, as pointed out, changed the world. So in 1925, 1926, Werner Heisenberg, Erwin Schrödinger developed modern quantum mechanics simply because, curiosity-driven, they're trying to understand how atoms interact with light and interact with each other. So that's in the 1920s, and quantum mechanics starts. A generation later, in the 1950s, the transistor and the laser are developed. And a generation later still, you get laptop computers, you get DVDs, you get cell phones, you get pretty much everything without which my children would say life is not worth living. None of those are possible without the transistor and or the laser, neither of which are possible without quantum mechanics. If you went to Schrodinger and said, nice equation, Erwin, what's it good for? I doubt very much he would say, well, if you want to store music in a compact digital format, but without these true superheroes of science, yeah, the world we live in would be profoundly different. Mm-hmm. There are more transistors in your phone right now than there are stars in the Milky Way galaxy. And this has, without this constant research, so to perhaps a bit unsung, is just the contributions of science to this, to how they've transformed everyday life, are perhaps not fully appreciated. In America, people think Steve Jobs invented the mobile phone, the iPhone. And Jobs' contribution was really deciding that the corner should be rounded rather than square off. There are many people who are doing the research that are transforming our lives, and perhaps we need to do a better job of communicating that to the general public because, as pointed out with the funding, they're paying for it after all.
Yeah. Well, on that note, Elodie, you spend a lot of time trying to bring science more into the focus of the public.
Yes.
Is that what we should be concentrating on?
Yeah, I think my angle is more, you were talking about the scientists, and I think people need to trust scientists because science is happening, it's amazing, and we see lots of discoveries. But if the public doesn't trust people doing those discoveries, they're not going to trust the science behind it. And we see lots of things happening like flat Earth, climate change, skepticism, and everything. And I think people need to trust, really, who is doing the research. So the person behind it needs to be a superhero for the public.
If we portray scientists more as superheroes, then do you think the public will be more inclined to trust science as a discipline and the results of science?
I think so. I think really. Well, I don't know if.
Well, that's something we can unpack later on.
But yeah, I really have the feeling that the scientists are really behind the science, but you don't really see them frontline, I would say. So, you know, usually you read lines, you read papers, you see journalists are writing papers, you know, you have some interviews, but what we do with Pint of Science is really putting the scientists in front of the public and really having a discussion like you would have with, like here, for example.
Well, good. So it's great to have you here. And well done, Pint of Science, for being a partner for tonight's event. All right, I want to pick up this thing then that has arisen over on this side. This question of whether pure curiosity-driven science, is that really separate from applied science that has results that we can all benefit from? Or are we just looking at the same thing from another direction? Is it useful to distinguish? Is it a mistake to distinguish?
I can say something about it. I think it is not very useful to distinguish, to make a sharp distinction. That is not sharp borders, but that depends a little bit upon which discipline you are in. If you are in theoretical physics, it's maybe different from when you are in chemistry, you know, because we work on fundamental problems of the molecular sciences and making materials, I said already, from drugs to dyes, from plastics to your car. There, although we work on very fundamental discoveries, the road towards application is always there. And people always look for, hey, if I discover something that might be a drug, pharmaceutical industry might be interested. Maybe I should patent it or whatever. What will it do to help? But that's not the start. Eh? It starts with very fundamental, basic questions.
So is it an obstacle to science then to start from the practical end when we could be starting from the fundamental?
It could be a problem. Yeah. It could be a problem. But you could be looking at something and really the solution is over there. And so if you're working for an application, you have a specific, you know, I need to make this thing fly. You might be thinking about it so much, but you'll never see that actually the solution is something else. It could be dark energy, or it could be whatever, could be out there that actually will completely revolutionize. And so you never know, and it's because you don't know, and it's unpredictable, it's evanescent, it's, you know, however, it's like magic. It's a magical event. It's a human It's a little bit like art, whether it works or it doesn't. It's a beautiful thing. And because you don't know, it's hard to make money. It's hard to save a country. It's hard to create jobs. And so people that are, you know, looking at the day-to-day, they don't really want to take that into account. They say, no, just solve this problem. And they don't understand that it's, you know, it's meandering. It'll find its own way.
I think it's absolutely essential to keep room for curiosity-driven research. And that's for a couple of reasons. One is that, as we've already heard, people don't necessarily know at the outset what the payoffs are going to be of the research that they're doing. So nobody who was working on number theory knew that number theory would then be absolutely essential for cryptography that's used all the time right now. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it's also a mistake if you put too much emphasis on the need for scientists to tell us what's the payoff going to be, then it encourages them to make grossly overinflated promises of what their technologies can deliver. And that comes back to bite them later on, because that can actually lead, I think, to some serious problems of undermining trust in science. You don't want to insist that scientists have to promise the Earth, because then when they do, they inevitably can't deliver. Making room for curiosity-driven research, I think, seems to me to be absolutely essential.
So, Elodie, it sounds as if there could be a problem from bringing scientists forward to say, look, we're doing this work, it could really save the world, it's really important, if then that raises people's expectations. So we do start to see scientists as superheroes that we can sit back and say, oh, it's all right, the scientists will save us. No, hang on, it's been 5 years now and they haven't saved us yet. This science thing is clearly rubbish. How do you work that? How do you balance that?
So usually the thing is, science takes time, and especially, I don't know, physics, but I know that biology takes really a lot of time, and you can waste months or a year just, you know, with nothing happening, like losing your cells, for example, or something really, really stupid. What we do usually, I think the good thing is to explain the road to there, because yes, it's not fast, it's not instant, but it can take time, and if people understand why it's taking time and someone is actually explaining to them, you know, to do that kind of experiments takes 6 months to do one experiment. So if you repeat to be sure it's actually a phenomenon I'm really seeing, it's going to take a year. And then I think it has to be, you know, taken to them, and the public has to know how it's happening really in the lab, because I think we're watching TV sometimes. Bad TV, and we're seeing experiments happening. You know, someone takes a tube, put it in a machine, and says, "Oh yeah, he's your father." And I'm a geneticist, and when I see that, honestly, I go really, really nuts, because no, it's not happening like that. But I think people just think, "Oh yeah, it's happening like in CSI, you know, in Les Experts." Yeah. It's like, no, it's not real. So they think it's just you put a tube in a machine, and then you boop, you get the answer. It's not that. So I think they need to see real people that can actually explain to them, yeah, it's taking time, and why? Why is it taking so much time?
Okay, I want to come back in the second half to look in more detail at this business of how we relate science to the public. Maybe we could turn a little to the internal dynamics of science and why people do science, what motivates people to stay in a lab for years and years trying to get cells to do something that they don't want to do, or looking for a particle that may not exist, or building molecules and seeing what they're capable of. What motivates people to do that? Jim, what motivated you? Surely it wasn't just that you thought the ties would be cool.
Well, it was mostly the ties. So it's questions that really speak to a person. And different things will speak to different people, and there's the arts and the humanities, and some people, it resonates with them and it just drives them. There's also the issue of you're not rolling back the frontiers of basic knowledge every single day, so a lot of it is also enjoying the day-to-day of what you're working on. But addressing questions that just bother you, that you don't understand or don't know. Of the two forms of carbon, diamond and soot, we know much more, we being physicists, much more about the properties of diamond And that's because in a several cubic centimeters of material, you'll have a trillion atoms. And if they're all arranged in a perfect ordered arrangement, you have mathematical tricks to find the properties of the material. But if you have not diamond, but soot, the atoms are randomly placed, and you can't use these tricks, and we don't understand the properties of soot, even though it's still carbon, it's the same element, the same material. And diamond is expensive precisely because it's rare. And the fact that you don't give a soot ring to your beloved as a sign of your affection, if you want him or her to remain your beloved, is a reflection of this. And it would be nice if we understood disordered materials and so these are this is an issue that's bothered me for going on 30 years now. And so I just would like to understand these better. But for different people, it's different things that kind of speak to them, I think.
So this brings us back to what you were both saying, in fact, earlier, which is the drive of curiosity, the drive of wanting to know, the human desire to unpack things. Is that really the only impetus that underlies science? Is there no part of a scientist that goes, if I discover this, I can save the world from global warming or Zika virus? Or are these things all inside you, in tension, pulling in opposite directions? Ben?
I never thought about saving the world, I think, except for discussions that we have now, like here. The sheer excitement about making discoveries and going in unknown territory to find out why and how. Why does nature... How is it possible that you are composed of atoms and molecules and sitting here and speak to me and think and are able to talk? Yeah. Why can we communicate? How does our body work? How do our cells work? It's still rather, despite all the advances in chemistry, physics, and biology, it's still largely a mystery, you know, how nature evolved to something like a human, the most complex organism that we know, as far as I know. Maybe there's something out in the exoplanets, I don't know, that I'm not aware of. But, and then what attracted me a lot to the natural science, and particularly chemistry, is that I can also create my own world. Because I can design molecules and materials that have never existed before. And we made many in our laboratories. There is endless opportunities. The world that you can create, yeah, the molecules, the materials, it's unlimited. So, and it attracted me a lot. And I remember the first time I got really excited was in the third year of my undergrad studies when I made a molecule and my American professor said, nobody in the world has ever made this molecule. It was absolutely useless. Coming back to your question for society. But it was, for me, absolutely beautiful. I got so excited about it that I made something like a piece of art or a piece of music. And this is what I've done ever since with my students.
You see, Tim, this sounds much more like something from the humanities or even philosophy, this desire to understand something, the question of how I can just basically be a pile of atoms, and yet we're all here having a discussion, our minds are communicating, this desire to create molecules that have never existed. How is that actually different from the arts and the humanities?
Well, okay, so the first thing to say is I think that in terms of scientists themselves, I think motivations are very, very different. They're a diverse group of people. There's no reason to expect them all to think in the same way. Often, absolutely, it's all about curiosity. Sometimes it's about curiosity joined to a sense that I want to be the person that gets there first. You very much get that sense when you're reading, say, James Watson's autobiography, for example. He didn't just want the truth to be discovered. He wanted the truth to be discovered by him. That was very important. Now, that kind of ambition is great. That can drive people. Often the very fact of ambition and the very fact of rewards is what we rely on to get these discoveries achieved. A worry for science is when the payoff structures tip over to a point that encourages people into bad forms of science, into scientific fraud, into falsification of results, for example. So we need to make sure that scientific careers are managed properly, I think. Is it a bit like philosophy? I think it is a bit like philosophy. And increasingly, you see, I think, people turning to science in the hope, often in the very well-justified hope, that it will give them answers to questions about the basic nature of morality, questions about free will, questions about the relationship between the mind and the body. Those are all questions where science has a lot to offer, I think, even though they're traditionally the kind of questions that philosophers were interested in.
So will philosophy just become a branch of science one day?
Well, historically, of course, one of the most influential movements in philosophy in the 20th century came from science. It came from a group of physicists and mathematicians who thought, we want to treat philosophy in the way that you would treat a scientific subject. And a large part of particularly Anglo-American philosophy comes from a really similar scientific background anyway. But again, it won't surprise you to hear, I don't think the scientists can do this all by themselves. There's a massive history of philosophical work on all of these questions. What we need to do is knit these subjects together better, so we better understand what the significance is of scientific results for philosophy. And that means collaboration, it means trusting each other, it means understanding each other better, I think, as well.
Jean-Marie?
Maybe there's two things I'd like to say on that. First, most scientists that I've met, and I've met a lot of scientists, most of them are very modest, very humble, because they know that they really, their power, you know, to understand is very small, and they depend on a lot of other things. And so they realize, now there are some huge egos, so a lot of them are very, very smart, and some of them have huge egos, but even if they're huge egos, they understand that they're very, very small in the grand scheme of things. And so there is a certain humbleness that is ever present. The other thing is you have what you call peer review, and it's a very democratic system, science. You know, you have your idea, you know, you write your paper, and then you publish it. And then everybody looks at it, everybody criticizes it, and if it holds water, it stays. And then, you know, it becomes whatever it can become, a Nobel or whatever else. So everybody, it's criticized. It's up to everybody to give their opinion. And that has a tendency to, it weeds out the people that are, that are no good, and it makes everything on the same level playing field.
I would say that that's a difference between the arts, for example,
yes,
and the sciences. Is that in the science, there is an accepted criteria,
yes,
for what is, when is something correct, and there's the testing, the experimental verification, because it could pass even peer review, but if it can't be reproduced, if it's a one-time and it's a one-off, then it has no real lasting value. And so there is within science, there's an accepted criteria for what is correct, and you would not necessarily find this in the arts, or music, that there are people who are out, there's the mainstream, there are people outside the mainstream, but when things have passed this vetting,
yeah,
we don't have to constantly recheck or relook. There's you can trust,
mm-hmm,
and build on that without having to redo everything. I want to do an experiment on my molecule. So first I better go back to Galileo and start dropping balls from a tower just to check that the mass doesn't change the acceleration. We can build on that and go on.
Isn't that why we sent people to the moon, so they could drop the hammer and the feather and just check that Galileo
It was basically correct, for an intro physics demo, yes.
So, Elodie, maybe then one thing that we should, and I will in a moment move on much more to talk about how we talk to the public, but maybe this idea of why scientists do science and the idea that it's within a system that's designed to, maybe even out this force of the ego and the competition and let us advance human knowledge in a kind of systematic way. Is that something that the public should feel more, know more about or feel more part of?
Yeah, I think so. I think really what I can see, it's been 5 years I'm doing communication, what I see is that people really don't know what's happening in the lab. from how we do science to how it's published, how it's validated and everything. Mm-hmm. So yeah, for sure, I think public needs to know that, mm-hmm. and it's a huge step towards trust. Because at the moment, people feel a bit like, you know, science is done in the lab, you have a scientist that has a great idea and then he finds something and then it's everywhere on the headlines, but it's not exactly like that. Yeah. It's checked several times.
You have lots of minions checking your maths at every point. Okay, on this note, I'm going to invite questions from people here in the room. You'll have to go old school, stick your hand up and ask a question. But I think people on the internet have been hopefully tweeting or otherwise sending in their questions. So let's have a look and see if we can answer any of those questions. 2 minutes. 2 minutes, okay. We have the technology is funneling questions from the internet. In the meantime, is there anybody in the room who would like to ask a question or extend an opinion? Mm-hmm. Okay, what I'll have to do, just to warn you, I'll have to repeat your question for the people at home. So you ask the question, I'll repeat it. Don't be unnerved. So excellent question from the audience. In an era where, for example, the Trump era in America, where there is quite a lot of official governmental marginalizing or even distrust of science mm-hmm. and scientists, how do we deal then with the question of relating science to the public? And I think that was partly addressed to you, yeah. Elodie. I think I'd like to kick off, but I will also come and see if anyone else has a thought.
I think it's a difficult one because when you have someone as powerful as Trump, it's difficult to say, oh, you know, you need to do that to counter what he says. It's really difficult. But I think mostly my point of view is that if people care, they are not going to let that happen. So, for example, if there is a cut in the government, if really people cared, they would say no, they would do demonstrations and everything. You know, something would happen and maybe the government wouldn't do that. So I feel like if they cared, it wouldn't happen. But it's true that in America, it's really a special situation where even if the public cared and the people were doing demonstrations, I'm not sure really would change Trump's mind anyway.
Well, yeah, okay. It's funny that the people who seem to be questioning the utility and value of science have no problem using the fruits of science. Mm-hmm. I mean, who do they think invented Twitter? And yet, you know, without the scientists, you wouldn't have that. But I think that is for not people in the administration who are concerned with getting rid of regulations simply for financial reasons, but really more to communicate again to the general public so that they could see the value and the benefit in their everyday lives. The things that we open up the newspaper, we read scientific discoveries that involve colliding black holes or the discovery of the Higgs boson at the Large Hadron Collider. And these are fantastic discoveries and they deserve every bit of attention that they get and Nobel Prizes. But if that's all that people hear, they think that that's all that science does mm-hmm. and is so divorced from their everyday lives that they don't see the value in the connection. So the challenge is to show people that if you disregard science, you're disregarding the scientific process. And if you disregard the scientific process, then your lives are going to be a lot poorer, both financially and in other ways.
But this, to broaden out a little from the American situation, should it be the responsibility of governments to fund scientific research? Or should governments be free to say, well, we have a lot of things that our money is funding, and I'm sorry, scientists, you have to find other sources for your money?
Well, I think...
sorry, please go ahead.
I think ultimately, you know, a lot of these things that we're using now, these iPhones, they've come out of, you know, all the 50s, the 40s, the 50s. The U.S. funded. They had a tremendous period after the Second World War and doing, where they funded fundamental research. And you had Bell Labs. You had amazing institutions that were able to do where you. What they did is you had a certain element of freedom. So you hired the best people, you gave them money, and then you said, go ahead and do it. Go and find whatever you want. And they found incredible things. And it was because you had the ingredient of freedom and you had the empowerment of the money to do that. And that's what government should actually do. Because nobody, if you look at the CERN and the billions of dollars that it takes to do that, no, even big companies, even Google doesn't have a resource to do that. Only big governments can do that. And so I think that government has a really strong responsibility and to produce, to do the research, and what it, the fruits that it produces over the years are endless. You know, all these applications that come out of that, it goes on for years and years.
So Ben, you've worked both in industry and...
I wanted also to take my iPhone to show it to Mr. Trump and say, is this an opinion? Indeed, it was 60 years ago when chemists and physics did the fundamental discoveries that made it possible that just 10 years ago we could introduce the iPhone, and my daughters who are students cannot imagine a society without iPhones. But what I wanted to make another point. Imagine that governments would not support science anymore. How would we train our young people, our students? Because the essence of the training of our students at the universities, at the institutes and colleges, is to confront them not with our knowledge of yesterday, of today, not even of tomorrow, but the knowledge they need, they have to look beyond the frontier to what they need to know for 10 years from now. Because in 10, 20 years, our young stars are going to shape the future. If we train them now, not at cutting edge insights, knowledge, the frontier of what we know, then we are already behind. So it's so essential for how we train the next generations that we work at the frontiers of our fields in all the disciplines.
And you can only learn by doing. That's the way to become a research scientist is to do science research. No one ever got a driver's license just from classroom instruction.
Exactly, and that comes to the point that you mentioned, that it takes 6 months, 2 years, sometimes 10 years, because you learn from your failures. It's so many mistakes. It needs so much perseverance. And we learn a lot from the things that don't work to make it all possible. And this is all part of the scientific endeavor.
Tim, you want to?
There are a lot of scientific fields that are just a long way removed from any obvious application. And it would be terrible if we looked back at, you know, the period around 2017 and said, well, funding into research in paleontology just shut down at that time because nobody could really see what the technological payoffs were going to be. So it's absolutely essential that governments maintain that curiosity-driven research. On the Trump question, I don't think we want to be saying, trust scientists, trust scientists, generally because telling people, you need to trust me, often puts them off and means that they don't trust you. We need to make sure that people can assess the trustworthiness of scientific institutions. And we need to make sure that those institutions are indeed trustworthy. One of the reasons why the Trump administration is so toxic is because it's not even clear that Trump is telling lies. I mean, his abuse of language is so extreme that it's hard to even follow whether it's asserting, not asserting, what he's saying at any moment at all. It's such a moving target. And that makes any kind of effort to assess the trustworthiness of what he's saying very, very difficult.
But don't worry. Universities survive for 1,000 years. The governments usually don't make it. I'm very positive about our future.
That's a long view. So rather old school, we have questions that have come in from the internet, from your newfangled iPhones, no doubt, written in pen on paper. See, like thousands of years ago at university. I think it's goat skin, in fact.
Hello.
Now, one of these questions is from a Parisian who should lead science, government or private industry? And I fear we've slightly just covered that in that conversation, although I am open to coming back to it a little later on. So I'm going to go to another question from Laurent Nicolas. Thank you, Laurent. Shouldn't scientists be more involved in political debates, engaging controversies? Shouldn't we need more scientists claiming that, yes, climate change is real, and no, the Earth isn't flat? I think that just picks up very nicely on the conversation we've just been having. So let's pursue, thank you, Laurent, for this question. Let's pursue this question. Tim, maybe come back to you. Should scientists just forget the objectivity of science and facts and say, no, I'm going to take sides on this and get stuck into debates?
I mean, on the climate change case, just going back to the question, the massive majority, overwhelming majority of scientists do think climate change is real, and they do think it's caused by humans. So one of the reasons why we get the feeling that it isn't is because in the past, some broadcasters used to feel as though they needed to have somebody from both sides in order to create a debate, which enormously distorted the actual picture of what was going on in science at the time. Should scientists get involved in politics? Scientists know things that everybody else needs to know as well. And so scientists do need to take what they know and bring that to the people who have the power to act on it. And actually, as a matter of fact, scientists do quite often get involved in the policy-making process in one way or another. They advise on issues about safety, they advise on technology policy, and it seems to me that responsible science absolutely needs to do that.
So is there a difference between the scientific authority of, as you say, knowing stuff, and a political authority of saying, and this is the policy that we should follow?
Okay, so I mean two things on that. First of all, the scientific facts don't usually point unambiguously in one direction as far as outcomes go. It's going to depend on what you value, what your priorities are. So in order to make a good decision, you need to bring a well-considered set of evaluations into dialogue with a good piece of scientific research. Slightly more controversially, it also seems to me that, I mean, as we've heard, scientists are often very modest. They're often very interested in, as they often put it, they want to stand on the shoulders of giants. They want to make sure that the work that they're doing adds in this cumulative, brick-by-brick way to the wonderful edifice of science that we have. If you want to do that, you have to make sure that every brick is really well constructed. That's one of the reasons why science takes such a long time. That's one of the reasons why scientists are so keen to stress the importance of peer review. Mm-hmm. When science is brought into contact with policy, there are times when too much focus on peer review can, it seems to me, slightly fetishize peer review. If a scientist has done some really valuable research that has something to say about an important issue, you don't necessarily want to wait around until the peer review's done before taking at least some note of that work. So it seems to me that there's a mode of science where it's about generating this wonderful edifice, and there's also a mode of science when it feeds into policy. And we need to be slightly flexible in how we think about the different roles of scientific advice in those different areas.
Elodie, how does this question of should scientists get more stuck into politics, how does that relate to what you were saying about trust and the public trusting scientists more? Do those two things fit together well? Is there a tension between trust and taking a political side?
I think it fits in a limited way, meaning like they have to do that, but not only politics, I think, because it's the same thing. Public doesn't always trust politicians. So if you take one side, you know, you might have half of the public saying, basically this side, I don't trust this president or this minister, so I'm not gonna trust the scientist that is on his side. So I think they need to be neutral as well, because if they are one side, you know, you can lose trust actually quite easily that way.
Do you think, I mean, I think you're right about politicians not being trusted. As a journalist, I'm always depressed to see the opinion polls where journalists and politicians are the least trusted group by the general public.
No, it's true. For example, a scientist, even a great scientist would work with Trump, everyone would say, oh, you know, he's a Trump administration, we're not going to trust him, for example. And that would be bad for the scientists, even if he's saying really great things. People might not trust him just because he's on someone's side. So I think they need to be neutral as well. Very important.
It's a tricky one.
Yeah.
Jim, is this something you come across?
Well, I mean, there is, as pointed out, and it's becoming more extreme in the United States, politics is becoming more tribal. And, if you're in one tribe or the other, and that pretty much ends the discussion and ends the debate. And so it would be rather dangerous, I think. I mean, I think I agree there's like one PhD scientist in the House of Representatives in the United States, none in the Senate. And I think there's definitely room to at least double that number. there is the danger of whether science gets sucked into that tribalism, and then if it gives people license to further disregard anything that they don't want to hear, because the tribalism is not just being driven by we have the superior facts. It's a much more emotional reaction. It's a much more complex thing to try to, and moving people out of that can be very challenging.
So if you took sides very visibly against the American government, then you might risk anyone who'd thought about voting for Trump saying, well, that's it, we're not going to trust physics anymore.
Yeah, I mean, there would be the guilt of by association and other aspects to that. It's a very tricky thing. At the same time, you need to maintain your integrity on what are the scientific facts and where they lead. But people right now are very, it's like doctors, what do they know? That type of an attitude.
Jean-Marie.
I think you have a basic human difference in the profile of a scientist and a politician. And so, again, as you said, science is, you have to, you're very cautious because it's what you call scientific excellence. Everything, it's a construction, as you said, it's a construction in excellence. And so you're very careful, but everything is pure and just perfect. And that's not the same thing if you're a politician. You know, anything goes as long as you get, your way in many ways. And I'm not trying to, talk down politicians. We need politicians too. But the fact of the matter is that scientists, because it's got to be so exact and they're so respectful of the truth and of the process, but they're going to have a hard time being in politics. And as you said, very quickly, they would feel like they would lose their integrity. So I think it's a difficult, and that's part of a weakness of the system is politics and science in the doing of it don't really mix that well.
Scientists believe there is a right answer.
Yes.
And if they work long enough and hard enough, they can find it. But in politics, sometimes you need to come up with a policy today.
That's right.
And you can't wait to get all the data and all the peer review done. You need an answer now. And those are, opposing thrusts that I still think it would be a good idea to have more people with an understanding of the scientific process in politics. But it's not necessarily true, I think, that a good research scientist is an ideal training to be a policymaker.
But if you look at it lately, I even have some I have some friends that are scientists, and in the situation where the country is in the U.S. in Santa Barbara, and in the country, in the situation that the country is now, they become so emotional that when they talk about politics, they're not objective anymore, even though they're scientists. But emotion is getting to them.
But Ben, as a prominent scientist, do you feel impelled that you should express political opinions, or do you feel constrained because you want to keep your scientific practice separate from the the dirty business of actually making policy?
Well, I don't know if the policy is dirty business, but I try to keep away from political opinions in the sense that I'm a scientist and I want to advocate the values of science, you know, what are facts and what is fiction, what do we know, what can we underpin, how can we give data, yeah, and what is real. I mean, if I talk about antibiotics, yeah, you can have all kinds of opinions about infections, but I know that under antibiotics, if you have an infection and you are going to die, if you take that antibiotic, you will probably survive. That's a fact. And we can explain that, yeah, the biological models, there are molecules, you know, that act as an antibiotic, etc. There's nothing to do with politics. Yeah, of course, you can decide not to give, to reimburse this kind of antibiotics to your public because of your health policy or whatever, but this is facts. And as a scientist, I try to keep to facts and data and insights with all the consequence that also a lot of things we don't know for 100%. It's the best model we have or the best solution we have at this point. We give people anti-cancer compounds, chemotherapy, yeah? Not because they all cure cancer, but some of them is simply the best we have at this moment to retard the process, to give them maybe a few years more to live decently. But it is extremely important and more important than ever that scientists, in my opinion, academicians in general, tell to the politicians, to the general audience, that we go out and we tell, you know, what is the value of science, what is facts, what is fiction, what are uncertainties, etc., all these things. I think we should do this much more than we do now. We have to recruit the media, we have to recruit everybody that can help us in this respect, because there is a lot about opinions completely separated from any fact. And that is scaring, you know, that you hear, okay, what is then the value of science? Why do people do this, etc.? There is a lot of things that we should bring to the public and make them comfortable with understanding what we really know, how we can help, etc. And I think this is a duty that we should immediately teach already our students, but also go to the general public. I go often to public events, I go to schools, etc., to help the teachers, to bring the message forward, also to politicians, and say, look, this is, yeah, what science can help you with or can bring or give you facts. This goes from climate change to new energy to drugs, to materials, whatever.
Jean-Marie.
I'd like to add to that, probably what science has been, I'd say, maybe not guilty of, but maybe a little bit careless, is that science tries to know. I mean, we work very hard to understand and to know, and it becomes very complex. If you look at science today, you know, most of them take a lot of mathematics, and it's not accessible to a lot of people, and so the composture has been to talk down onto people that don't know. And so you have sometimes scientists take this position, I'm the one who knows, and you people don't know, and so you have to trust me, and you have to listen to me. And people don't like to be talked that way. And they want to be respected. And so there's been this, I think we're running to the end of a cycle where people have been tired of being told without understanding, but you have to trust. And to be talked down onto, and I think it's a movement, and we need to come to a new balance where there's actually a discussion that ensures that there's respect on both sides.
Elodie, this seems like the perfect time to come to you so you can finally reveal the mystery and describe what is Pint of Science and why do you do it?
Okay, so Pint of Science is a festival that is happening every May. 3 days, three evenings, since 2013, so first time in UK, and then we expanded in the world. And the idea is that we take scientists and we put them in pubs or bars and to talk about their research to the public directly and in a relaxed way, because we realize that the public really wants to know what's happening, but it's really difficult to take, let's say, a group of people in a lab because, you know, of the restrictions, the dangers and everything. But we realize it's really easy to take science to the public. So it's what we're doing every May, and it works. Yeah, it works really well. Researchers really enjoy that, but usually they are stressed because they think that talking to the public is a bit dumbing down their research, and it's not. And we need, as you said, to train them to learn how to speak to the public and do it effectively. But yeah.
So what's the hardest scientific concept that a scientist has ever explained in a bar over a beer?
It's a difficult question. I think there is no hard concept, it's just the way you're explaining it. I think I'm always saying to everyone, there is no impossible subject. It's just the way you explain it. It might take a bit longer to find the good angle to talk about it, but there is nothing that you shouldn't be able to talk about with the public.
Mm-hmm. So I could understand general relativity just over
yeah.
a pint.
Yeah. Yeah, really, you should
well,
be able...
pint moving away so quickly, it becomes like a red ale in the red shift. So, James, this is also presumably the same kind of idea that you have with the physics of superheroes.
Right. So I agree, following up on something you just mentioned and connecting to the superheroes, I think that a lot of people are not necessarily anti-intellectual, but they're anti-snobbery. Mm-hmm. They don't like being talked down to or saying, listen, you know, you're stupid if you don't do this. I mean, that's a sure way to get people to shut down. The other way that shut down is if you can't explain it in an accessible way. Mm-hmm. Because even those people who are interested in understanding what's going on in science have an insecurity about their ability to understand the math and science. So if I'm explaining my work to one of my colleagues in the physics department and I do a bad job of it, she will interrupt me. She will ask me questions because she has a confidence that she should be able to understand what I'm saying. So if I mangle something, she'll interrogate me. But if I do the same bad job explaining it to my next door neighbor, he will think that he didn't understand because he's not quote unquote smart enough. And it's just because I didn't explain it in a clear enough way. But if you tell the same story with Spider-Man or Superman, the shields don't come up right away. And if you can tie it to some sort of story or narrative, then there's a greater chance that people will recall it and understand the value of it.
Now I understand why you carry the tie.
Yep. Also, I'm a nerd. And a geek.
Mm. No, but it's
sorry, I'm already married.
It's true that...
Three or four hearts broken in the room, let alone probably millions on the internet.
No.
Elodie, sorry,
yeah, but I lost it now.
I'm sorry.
Was it about the narrative, the superheroes, the
okay, we'll
the
come
broken
back
hearts? Okay, I'll come back to you. Tim, I wanted to ask you this. So this thought, which I think is a definite trend at the moment, to seeing science as something that should be brought to everybody, everybody should understand it, everybody should feel involved and have a say in it. Are there any downsides to that, or is that just something that's long overdue?
Well, I don't think there are any downsides to it. I mean, I don't see what would be bad about everybody having a thorough understanding of science. I mean, one might say, does it go for other things as well? Should everybody have an understanding of history and how people do history? Would it be better if everybody knew what was involved in going to an archive, for example? Well, presumably not there. So I guess the question is, what is it that we're picking up on about science that means that we think science in particular is something that everybody should have a grip on? And I guess part of the reason comes back to the idea of science and democracy. So it comes back to the idea that there are really significant questions that we need to grapple with right now about artificial intelligence, about climate change, about disease antibiotic-resistant bacteria, for example. All of these kinds of questions. people, if they want to be responsible citizens, need to have some kind of a grip on those questions. And it's very, very hard to get any kind of grip on that unless you have basic skills that tell you where to look for information, who to trust, what looks like a good, plausible piece of research, and what looks like a load of nonsense.
But just to be a devil's advocate for a moment, could you not make exactly the same argument about history, or, for that matter, philosophy? I mean, if we want to have a democratic discussion about the kind of policies we have about genetic engineering, for example, surely that there's a big moral component in that. Should we not also have a public understanding of philosophy where we all have at least a passing knowledge of Kant and whoever else the other philosophers would be?
I don't think you're advocating for the devil, but you're advocating for the angels there, I think. No, look, all of these questions typically have a significant scientific dimension, but then they also have a dimension that's not straightforwardly a scientific one as well. So questions about genetic engineering, for example, questions about genome editing. On the one hand, we want to know what's technically feasible, what might those techniques actually be able to achieve, so that we don't go off on an ethical debate about a science fiction scenario that's never going to come to pass. But at the same time, we also want to think, well, what would be so bad about intervening in the germline? What would be so bad about augmenting our talents if we could do that using these technologies? And it's hard to make any headway there unless you bring, on the one hand, a moral sensibility, maybe use some tools from philosophy, but you also really need to know how the science works as well.
So there you are. We need to know philosophy and science and probably some history. That's no more going out drinking for any of us, really. We're at home reading from now on. Is there something special about science that the public should be more part of, more than just these practical questions? Is science something that everybody in the world needs to be part of?
Well, I think you're right. I think that there's some issues, policy issues, that if you just take GMOs, for instance, you have
genetically modified organisms.
Yes,
yeah.
And you have a way that they look at it in the U.S., the way they look at it over here in Europe. It's a drastically different way of looking at it. Maybe it's because in the U.S. they don't, you know, business decides what happens, and over here business doesn't in the same way. And so you have a perception is a lot, and people are worried, and so they need to understand the issues. They need to be educated, as you say, and then understand the issues to understand what is the risk, and they have to make a basic decision on what's the level of risk. But to understand that, you need to go very far into the problem, and you need to educate yourself very highly. So yes, I would say that a number of questions like that need to be really looked at, and you have to keep the emotion out as much as possible, but at the same time you have to respect the emotion in the people, because it's a fact and you can't force it on people. So yeah, all those things need to be accounted for.
This is something that's starting to come up a few times in this discussion, is that on the one hand we have science as this very cool, objective, a system that involves building on facts and testing theories. But then we also have, you said something about stories, you said something about trust, the emotion has come up, worry. If science is to become a much wider part of culture, how do we mix these things? How do we mix the emotion and the stories and the trust with the objectivity that we look for in science? Ben, I'm afraid I'm just looking at you for a first answer here.
Yeah, no, I think you can explain it to the general public. Of course, you have to, and to politicians and to anybody, also to elementary school kid, you have to take part in that discussion and step aside from your own cocoon as a scientist or your own community and go into that community. So what does a layman who is not a scientist know about it? When I talk, it was mentioned here, gene editing. When we talk about big changes that we will see in the coming 20, 30 years, think about rewriting your genes at the level of an embryo, as was done last summer, you know, for the first time. How far do we want that? If you have an inheritable disease, I would say consider it seriously. Otherwise, that's an ethical discussion, you know? What do we want? Rewiring the brain. So not too far from now, we will have chips implanted in your brain. Yeah. You know, when you get a little bit older, you know, to remember things, or when you have other kinds of age-related defects, how far do we want to go? People say, oh, this is science fiction. This will never happen. It will happen within 10 years, I tell you. Maybe. But no, certainly it will come.
He's been right before.
It will come. And then, do we want that? No, yes, maybe. People say, I spoke to several people say, oh, no, I don't want to rewire my brain. But then you take a hip implant, you take a stent, you take all these things, you know, that make life more pleasant when you have something. Why not a chip? Yeah? But then you might say, yeah, then my mother can control me with remote control. I don't want that. Okay, that's another discussion, you know? But of course, there will be dramatic technological advances in the coming decennia. And we have to engage with the general public in this kind of debates, yes. And I try to do that. And I think we all should do that. I see it as an obligation of science that we get into this open debate, because it's much better to think about it, to discuss it, and the consequences of gene editing, etc., and say, what do we together as community, as society, want in the future?
Because the decisions on this will not and should not be made solely by scientists.
No, no.
They have to be made by everyone.
Of course.
And so the issue is that people, more than having an opinion about archives and things, they're called upon as citizens and voters to have opinions on scientific questions. And we want them to not just say, oh, you're the scientist, do whatever you think is best. They need to be able to make the decisions. And the more that they know, the more they can make something that is decisions that are technically sound rather than just sound technical.
Just before I come back to Elodie, I have one more question waiting here. We probably have time for one more question from the internet, if anyone is burning to send one in. So I'll just flag that up now, so we have a couple of minutes to get it through the high-tech system and to me. Elodie, so emotions, stories,
yes,
science, how do these things fit together?
So I think for me the basis of science communications are emotions and storytelling. Because if I come to you tomorrow and I start explaining, oh, I'm working on that, giving you equations, or you know, just science facts, you're going to be like, yeah, what? why is it relating to me? Why are you telling me that now? If I come to you and I explain to you, you know, I'm working on that disease, it's, you know, it's a disease really quite common, 1% of the population, let's say. I'm interested in curing it that way and trying to put my science into the story, then you're going to be interested. So you catch the public by telling a story with a bit of science in it.
So you say you have a chip for my brain that will help me remember people's names instead of forgetting them all the
time.
Yeah,
if I was talking about that chip, for example, I would explain why, you know, what it would do, how it would work, but telling a story, and sometimes I tell the researchers as well, tell the story why you're working on that, because it can help to see your passion through the subject. You know, why do you like it so much? Why are you spending hours in your life on that subject, that little tiny question? Why is it so important for you? And I think that's the basis of science communication. If you just state the facts, it's going to be really boring. People are not going to want to listen to that. Mm-hmm. They want to listen to why and what and why is he doing, and oh, okay, the researcher is doing that and he's interested in that thing. And then you're going to go through the story with him or her. You know, you're going to feel, oh yeah, you're interested. You're going to feel interested, you know? And I think it's really the basis. So it's really difficult to separate emotions from science and science communication, because I think it's really...
But it's also because we are trained like this way, and we train our students like this
way.
Because we have to write publications that are refereed, etc. And that should be based on facts and on analysis and theory and mathematical formulas and whatever. We don't put emotions in there. If we put emotions or passion or the way we discover it or whatever, they will immediately edit it out. Sometimes we say, this is an exciting, then I get a message from the editor, if it was not exciting, we shouldn't publish it.
Sorry. Yeah, so that's why science communication needs training, and it's a real work. Yeah. Because
because you're undoing all the training.
Exactly,
that
you're undoing all the things.
To be objective.
It's basically going against everything you're doing in the lab. You know, the way you communicate with scientists, you're just doing the exact contrary.
But yes, but
Jean-Marie is.
But I think, in some sense, you're testifying. You're sharing what your emotion is about, and I think that's a beautiful thing. So. There's two processes. The one is you're the scientist and you're doing everything objectively based, and then afterwards you just have to tell your story of what's motivating you and what your passion is. And so it's something that you have to flip into another world so that you can relate that world.
But at the start, when you were talking about curiosity and the desire to find things out, and the uncertainty there, you were quite passionate about that.
I am.
Are they two separate things, really? Or is this just that we happen to have developed a culture within science that is, it wasn't a person doing it, the experiment was done, but there was no person there. Is that a mistake? Tim, you want to say something?
Well, I mean, a scientific paper is written in order to make it look as though no real human was involved in the production of the work, and nature simply spoke. Of course, in reality, that's not how it works at all. In reality, scientists, as you can see, are people too, and they have emotions. And they do get into the business because they're incredibly enthusiastic, because they're driven in various kinds of ways. And one thing that's really important to remember is we shouldn't go around saying, oh, emotions are inevitably irrational. And there's actually some very good scientific work pointing out the ways in which when people really have no emotions at all, they can't make any good decisions. Mm-hmm. So actually emotions are not irrational, they're essential to good decision making. Mm-hmm. But this also comes back to a question about whether or not scientists should, and you said they shouldn't, and I think you're right, whether scientists should be left in charge of deciding what various technological directions should be when we're thinking about AI or genome editing. Right. And there it seems to me there are very good reasons why you wouldn't want to leave scientists involved on their own. And that's because there's always uncertainty about these areas. And when there's uncertainty, because scientists are humans like everybody else, your emotions, your enthusiasms will affect your judgment. And so would you want AI policy being dictated by a bunch of people who dedicated their lives to enthusiastically working on AI policy? Well, you know, those AI specialists will know the facts, but they're also going to have a bunch of very specific views about the kind of robots they'd like to hang out with in the future.
I just wanted to chip in. There was a question that came in earlier that is really, really aimed at you, although I think other people might come back to this. I think it's from Lola. Mm. I might be reading that wrong. I'm sorry. This is the vagaries of human handwriting, which is uncertain, like all things. If I got your name wrong, I'm sorry. But your question is great. It's, what difference does it make when it comes to popularizing to be a Nobel Prize winner? Are you more free?
No, I was, before I got this nice award in Stockholm, I was already often at schools and at public events and so to advocate the importance of science and why science is so beautiful. It makes a bit of a difference in the sense that I get many more invitations, of course, so I have to say no often. But I think also what I see is a bit of a difference is that when I go to The Hague or to Brussels, you know, to the politicians, etc., that they listen. At least I get the feeling that they listen when I try to advocate, you know, the importance of fundamental science, but also the link towards industry, you know, to cooperate with industry on some of the real pressing problems for the future. Eh? How are we going to drive in our car, for instance? Or how are we going to tackle the problem of antibiotic resistance that was mentioned earlier? These are serious problems. So, yes, it helps a bit, you know, I think because I was on TV, I was on several events, and they know I got this award in Stockholm. And if you are open to it, and I think for me it is part of my passion, you know, to bring to the public why science is so beautiful in all its diversity, you know, the humanities, the sciences as I do it, here, the physics, the biology, etc. I think these are all aspects of this beautiful endeavor which we call science as part of our culture. And indeed, coming back to this issue of passion and etc., people always think, you know, that we are extremely rational. And of course, I have to work with chemical formula and mathematical formula. But a lot of things I do also based on intuition. And people ask me sometimes, why are you making this molecule? I say, I love it. It's a beautiful molecule. Can you explain why it's beautiful? I don't know. It's like a Van Gogh painting. And sometimes it's extremely useful because it brings in new component for a new battery or a new catalyst for the industry or a new drug. But not always, eh?
But that's
sometimes
not why
you it's do just it. Member or part of my passion for wanting to know, wanting to discover.
We probably do have time for one more question if there is one. Oh, there's a couple. Okay, I don't know if we get through both of these, but let's have a go. Oh, there's three, in fact. Okay. So from Epics. From Epics, which I assume is an organization, or it's a person whose parents have even more of a sense of humor than my parents when they called me Timandra. Should companies get more involved in scientific popularization and hire more mediators to showcase the research done in their laboratories to the public in order to strengthen the public's trust in science? Now, that's an interesting question, because we've kind of talked about popularization, democratization is something governments might want to encourage, or something that individual scientists are burning to go out and do, or that universities might want to do. But with companies, they are sometimes a bit reticent about the science that's done. Is that something that companies should do more of?
The,
Tim?
The history doesn't look very promising there. So the example I have in mind, one of the worst public debates that was conducted in the UK was the debate about GMOs, genetically modified organisms. And one of the reasons why that seemed to go so badly was because Monsanto tried to orchestrate it. They were one of the very early players in trying to generate debate around GMOs. And far from that boosting trust, it just led everybody, or many people in the UK, to come to the view that GMOs were a big con that were being thrust on us by a few very, very privileged companies. So, the historical signals don't look very promising.
But what can companies do then? Because in a sense, they can't win. If they don't try and go out to the public, then they're secretly trying to do something evil. And if they do try and go out to the public, you're saying that that makes people more suspicious.
They have to be listening. Mm. If you listen to what the public has to say and what the fears are, you have to address these fears. And they has to be, it has to be a two-way street. If you're trying to impose your views because you want to make a lot of money, it's not going to work. So you have to be on the listening end, too.
That's something we've actually not talked about as much, have we? We talked a lot about talking to the public, but listening to the public is something we maybe need to throw into the equation. Elodie, does Pint of Science also involve the public coming back and saying, take your memory brain implants away. We'll write things down if we want to remember them.
No, we give lots of time at the end of every discussion, at the end of every presentation for discussion. So public can actually ask questions to the researcher. So
that's also
actually it's quite funny, because we got some feedbacks from that, and some researchers said that it really helped them to see the big picture of their research, because they are so used to work on, as I said before, you know, a tiny question. When someone is asking, you know, why are you doing that? What's the whole point? It's just a very naive question, but it makes them question the whole thing they are doing. And sometimes some researchers came back to say, it was really good, because I think I lost the track of my research, and having really naive questions put me back on the track and put me gave me a good angle to actually see my research.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
I fully agree. It is really important, you know, to get the public engaged and to listen carefully to the questions, because you cannot blame everybody that they are not scientists and they don't know all the data and all the facts, you know. I often had this debate with the public about nature versus artificial, because I'm a chemist, we built new materials, etc. And then I use this example because people say, ah, Mother Nature is so much better or green, you know, and whatever. And I said, look at the flying bird, a pigeon. When the Wright brothers were building for the first time in 1903 a plane, a very primitive one, and were flying for the first time in mankind, a few yards, yeah? People say, why do we need to fly? If we wanted to fly, God would have given us wings. We admire the flying bird, God's creation. But to carry 350 people at 900 kilometers across the ocean, 10,000 miles, you don't take much advantage of a flying bird. But you can build a Boeing or an Airbus here in Europe, and it does its job beautiful, and it's completely artificial. So I think we should also listen carefully to the questions and try to give insight in what perspective certain things are done, you know, with respect to discoveries, with engineering, with insights from science, etc., and how it can then bring forward mankind and society, and how we came to the society that we have today, and where we will be in 20, 30, 40 years from now. And I think it's important that we listen carefully and try to translate it. Yeah?
So
not that we have all the answers, but at least we can add to some facts and some insights.
So listen, but also don't be afraid to give an answer and argue.
Don't be afraid to argue.
Yeah. I mean, you talk about, and getting back to what you started with science saving the world or changing the world, 1903, the Wright brothers. 66 years later, Neil Armstrong walks on the moon. Yeah. And that's not just from following nature or what, but that is showing in this a single person's lifetime, you go from flightless to going to the moon and coming back again. And that is a contribution of science that is impossible to ignore. And I think that was why back, you know, in the 60s or in 50s, scientists were held with more respect than they are today. They had made major contributions to the winning of World War II, and they were it was clear that people could see their societies being transformed.
Well, this brings me on actually to another question that's come in, which is perhaps a provocative response to that. It's a question from a physics student in Paris. Greetings, anonymous physics student. And this physics student says, the public is tired of having to believe the scientists only because they are scientists. Mm-hmm. Any solution? So maybe the public are going back to the Royal Society in the UK has as its motto, nullius in verba, take nobody's word for it. Maybe the public are just going back to that and saying, well, just because you've been to the award in Stockholm, as you so coyly put it, just because you're a scientist and have qualifications we don't understand, why should we listen to you? So why should they listen to scientists?
Let me make one thing clear. I have more questions now than I had 30 years ago. I only got more questions. I feel more uncertain because I understand less, despite the fact that we worked 30 years, you know, on nanoscience and all these things. So, and when I look at Mother Nature, we should be pretty humble. On the other hand, we can build an Airbus, which is a fantastic machine, yeah? Mm-hmm. And if you as a, of course we should make clear to the general public that we don't have answers to all questions and that they should also look at this with a critical attitude. But on the other hand, let me take once again this example of energy of the future. If we want to drive electric cars, you can discuss all kinds of opinions, but in the end, we have to build batteries. And we don't have those batteries that we will all drive in electric cars. So we have to do something. We have to invent something. That's what they ask us as scientists. Please invent it for us, because otherwise in 30 years we will not drive in the electric cars. If the antibiotic crisis, you know, continues as it's going, there will be a lot of people dying in the future. That's the prediction by the world, not my prediction, but by the World Health Organization. So I'm more than happy to debate, and that's what we should do with the general public, but the facts are that we have to discover new antibiotics. Otherwise, we have a very serious problem in the future. Now, this is not to scare people, but it's just, let's face the facts and we have to do something. And this is the kind of open dialogue that we should have, I think. But once again, scientists should be humble because we, as I said, a call from Stockholm does not give you more credit than any other scientist, except that we apparently discovered something. But I feel very, I have many questions and feel very uncertain about, but otherwise, you know, there's so many things that I don't know. Actually, honestly, I bought some new study books because recently I was at the elementary school and kids ask me, oh, you are a professor who got a Nobel Prize, you know so much. And I said, look, I just bought some new books to study again. And they were shocked by the idea that I had to study again, to go to school, to learn. This is the fate of a real scientist.
So Elodie, is this part of the answer that in order to gain the trust of the public, it's partly about making more material advances so that people can see that science is producing things for the common good, but also about being humble and listening and saying we're still learning?
Yes.
Or is there another answer?
No, I think that's the answer, because if you come and you just say, you know, I know everything, people are not going to really want to listen to you. They like people humble and that have story to tell. Even if you have a failure story, it goes well because they feel like you are human. You know, I think we need to be more human, and humble goes with human. And yeah, to get the trust, you really need to show this is the human work behind the science. And
What do you think, Jim? Maybe superheroes is, maybe you've got to go back and rewrite. Like, oh,
well, if you go
why
back,
scientists are not superheroes.
Well, if you go back to, say, Marvel Comics, before they were publishing Fantastic Four and Spider-Man, they published comics like Tales to Astonish and Journey into Mystery. And every month, the Earth was being attacked by some giant monster from another planet, another dimension. Orgol, Roomba, Mambu, Gugam, Son of Goom. They always had these ridiculous names. And local law enforcement was helpless. The military couldn't stop them. And Earth would be doomed if not for the efforts of one lone scientist who inevitably would figure out the Achilles heel in some O. Henry-type twist. And in one issue, 1962, Tales to Astonish number 13, Groot, who would later show up in the Guardians of the Galaxy, first tried to take over the Earth, and Evans the scientist, who was disregarded and neglected by other people, figures out the way to defeat Groot. And in the last panel, the sheriff says, well, I'll be. I never even thought of that. And a townsperson says, that's why Evans is a scientist, and you're only a sheriff. And Evans' wife hugs him and says, oh, darling, forgive me. I'll never doubt you again. Never. I can't tell you how often I hear that in my own household.
How
primarily because it involves imaginary numbers.
Well, but maybe that no longer works. Maybe today would be the sheriff's wife hugging them and saying, darling,
I mean, again,
thank
the issue
you
is,
were here
people will respect science because science gets the job done. It builds the Airbuses, and the Airbuses work. And as Neil deGrasse Tyson says, science is true even if you don't believe in it. And so the Airbus will take the skeptics and the scientists to the destination at the same time. And we just need to, you know, advertise that more.
Okay, we are cantering towards a close. I actually just wanted to throw in, before I come to your answer on this side, about why should the public continue to trust scientists because they're scientists, or should they? But we have an opinion, not a question, from Vincent Colgrave, or possibly Vincent Colgrave. I'm not sure. I can say where Vincent is from. It's just a point saying, well, basically, science is like a startup: fail fast and adapt. So feel free to respond to that if you like, but you don't have to. I think it's just a contribution to the debate.
That was pretty much Karl Popper's view.
Yeah. You are, Vincent. Yeah. Karl Popper got there before you, but I think you're standing on the shoulders of a pretty important giant there. So public, tired of trusting scientists just because they're scientists, what's the solution? this is basically going to close the debate as well. No pressure.
Well, I think we've been talking about it. It's been about having a debate and explaining what science does well, and understanding what are the dangers and where it has to be mitigated. And so the debate is part of it. I think that's the solution. It's education.
Listening, debating, arguing. Yes.
I'm not sure if I agree with you that the public is tired of scientists. I think, in general, the
it's the public saying.
Yeah, I think in general there is quite a good attitude, you know. But we should do a much better job. We as scientists, I argued sometimes, you know, that every scientist who writes more than one paper every year, which for the natural sciences is quite normal, should also write a short paper on explaining what in this field or what in his lab or what in his institute has been discovered to make it a popular science article. Mm-hmm. So you can only get a grant or money from the government if you also every year write a popular science article explaining what was the major advance or discovery, etc. I've not seen much action there, but I think we could do a lot more. And I know people here do fantastic things, but I think we should advocate that. It's our duty, you know, as and particularly I feel it as my duty also as a teacher at the university, you know, to bring it to the general public.
Well, a lot of funders now do make it a condition of funding that there should be some public engagement. I will come back to you, but I know Tim.
I don't think there's a general problem of trust in science. And actually, if you look at surveys, it comes out exactly as you'd imagine, which is when scientists work for universities, they're often very highly trusted. Yeah. When they work for industry and government, they're less highly trusted. You know, what can we do to make things better? Well, I think actually the problem isn't with science. The problem often is with the way in which scientific advice is then taken up and processed by government. That's when science starts to look bad sometimes. It's when scientific advice is then taken into government U-turns, contradictory policies, nobody really follows through. And that's often just a problem with the way that government's organised to take up that advice and take soundings from broader parts of the population, I think.
So the politicians who know they're not trusted thinks, well, hey, people trust scientists, though. Let's get them on board and make them stand at the front.
And I think scientists have sometimes been too keen to take that poison chalice as well. I think sometimes scientists have thought, oh, government's asking me to do something really important now. Yeah, I'll do that. And then suddenly they realise actually they've been made to look rather bad because it never went the way they thought it was going to. The policy wasn't formulated in the right kind of way and so forth.
But I would also, coming back to your very first question about heroes, etc., I would really argue that we as press, as public journalists, etc., could do a little bit a better job to advocate the young stars in the field of all the sciences. Because if there is any prize in whatever media or culture or whatever, it gets always broad attention. But there are many, many young stars in every country that do fantastic scientific insights, discoveries, whatever, write books, etc. And they hardly get attention, and it's a real pity. It's nice that I got to Stockholm and I got a lot of attention, but I feel a bit that, sorry for all these young stars, you know, that hardly get any attention, while every almost mediocre soccer player gets in the press. Sorry to say this. Just let me advocate for the young stars in sciences, you know, our educators, the people that encourage the young, our kids, you know, the young people. I think they should get a little bit more attention. They deserve it.
Well, maybe that should be the next event, if this event is the first of a series. On that note, I'm afraid we're slightly overrunning. The discussion was so good that I allowed us to overrun. So I hope nobody at home is having their dinner burnt because we've gone on a bit too long. So I'm sorry we've run out of time because we clearly could go on discussing for even longer. But I hope this is the beginning of a much longer conversation through events like this, through Pipe of Science, through lots of other activities. And I would like to just end by thanking, obviously, all the partners involved in tonight, especially the organisers, Solvay Group and the Social Media Club of France. And I'd like to thank all of you for taking part, people watching through the internet and people in this room who've been very attentive and contributed your question. Thank you very much. And finally, maybe at home we can't hear you, but we will feel the completely unscientifically feel the waves of your appreciation, but certainly people in the room, if you could join me in thanking our terrific panel for a really, really interesting discussion. Thank you all, and goodbye.